Hello, hello, this is Carl.Tech, and today I'll give you a bit of a teaser trailer for a new course on cryptoeconomics. This is going to give a introduction and a high-level overview of all the topics that we'll cover in the course. So, let's get started. Cryptoeconomics in introduction. So, in 2008, a small group of gerbils got a brilliant idea, and this was Bitcoin, and subsequently the entire field and technology of cryptoeconomics, a coin termed by Vitalik. And this technology, this design space, gave these gerbils some superpowers. And those superpowers allowed them to create public, decentralized blockchains that all of humanity can use for consensus formation. And, you know, these things, whatever they are, stirred up a lot of attention and gotten a lot of media attention, and more people were starting to notice and take note. But that is not really the point. It's not about hype. It's not about the hype engine. It's about making the world a better place. And so that's what these blockchains can do. And for that to actually happen, it can't just be a couple, you know, little gerbils that understand how this stuff works and how to build new systems. It has to be more and more and more, as many people as possible to be able to design these cryptoeconomic protocols. And that's how we can actually make a difference. And so to further this end, myself and others are working on a course called Cryptoeconomics in Introduction. And this is a course that will go over core concepts of cryptoeconomics and design patterns that are useful for designing these systems. And also it will include a coding project for the people who want to dive deep and actually code things up. And if you don't, that's okay too. You can just learn how this stuff works. So the structure of this course will start out with PayPal, a centralized payment processor, and then we will implement Bitcoin, which, you know, make it decentralized. And then from Bitcoin, we'll make it even more secure by creating a plasma chain. So what is the actual makeup? Well, there's lectures on cryptoeconomics.study, lectures.cryptoeconomics.study, and there's also a book that will be on book, and there's also a forum. So if you want to, you know, ask questions and interact with me and the rest of the community, please do. That's awesome. And so now let's dive right in to building a decentralized PayPal. And this is, you know, turning a centralized payment processor into a decentralized one. This is what we'll do in the course, just on a very high level. So start out with apply transaction. There's a state and state transitions. The state, you know, for instance, has a balance of, you know, an account and a balance. And then the transaction shows a, you know, sending 65 from one address to another. And then there's a new state where the 65 has been sent to a new address and 35 is remaining. So, you know, very simple. It's just, you know, take a state, add a transaction, you get a new state. Very, very simple. So during this section, what we'll learn is we'll learn about cryptographic primitives like hash functions and signatures and, you know, pretty easy stuff, not too bad. But now it gets a little bit more complicated when you think who runs the code. Because, well, in our initial version, we'll have a central payment operator. And so these blocks over here, basically, they represent just the transactions and then those state transitions that we talked about earlier. And so the problem with the central payment operator is that there is no censorship resistance, and there's a bit of a, you know, the power is not equally distributed amongst the participants. There's a little bit too much power. And so what censorship resistance really means is we've got the king is able to, like, you know, the operator is able to censor different users, and, you know, that's not great, and even change the history and delete transactions from the actual history. So that's really not great. And we also have no fraud resistance. So because we don't have any guarantees on, you know, the central operator, you know, deleting stuff or changing the history, they can kind of accumulate coins and then just, you know, bag them up, grab them, and make off with the money. So this is, you know, not great. So we can do better. Well, one way we can kind of naively do better is by removing the central operator, by, you know, demoting their king status and just getting everyone to run the code that we had just written for PayPal. So that seems kind of reasonable. You can remove the central operator at all. And you start to get this system which looks a little bit like, you know, Bitcoin or Ethereum already, right? You have these everyone's running the system and sending transactions back and forth. So the question is, which order do we send those transactions? And that is actually a big deal. So let's say we have two transactions, gold gerbil sending to the brown gerbil, and then gold sending to the white gerbil. And the thing is, which comes first? Which order do we put these in? And this is actually an important question, because this is the kind of double spend issue, where the ordering number one, let's say the gold gerbil has 10 coins and sends it to the brown gerbil, and now the gold gerbil, that, you know, that's just fine, and the gold gerbil now has zero coins and tries to send 10 to the white gerbil, but that gets rejected, of course, because the gold gerbil doesn't have enough funds. So in the end, we have the gold gerbil with zero and the brown gerbil with 10. In the other ordering, the gold gerbil sends to the white gerbil first. And so that transaction goes through, sends to the brown gerbil, that one's rejected, and now we have the white gerbil with 10 coins. That is a different state, a different history. That is a problem. Now, which one do we choose? Which one is the real history? Well, the brown gerbil is going to say his was first, and the white gerbil will say hers was first. So, you know, This is an issue, and we need, well, decentralized consensus. We need to figure out, we need to come to agreement on what the ordering is. So let's see what we'll learn during this little exercise. We'll learn about client-side validation, and we'll also learn about some synchrony assumptions and while we're implementing this. But now, let's get into decentralized consensus. So with everyone running the transactions, we still need consensus on ordering. So we're going to take PayPal and turn it into Bitcoin. Now, decentralized consensus. Let's see what this is. So we have this group of users, and these are just the people running the protocol and, you know, using the system. And we also have this group of miners/validators, just different names for the same stuff. Now, users are going to generate transactions and send them. Miners are going to decide on the ordering of those transactions. Now, the users can actually become miners. So they can just decide, oh, actually, I want to contribute to consensus formation. And they can become a miner. And remember, this applies to all decentralized consensus protocols, whether it be proof of work, proof of stake, etc. Now, they're different. You have different levels of flexibility on who can join. And sometimes there are barriers of entry, but a nice decentralized consensus protocol will have porous boundaries where anyone can really become a miner and start validating the forming consensus. So great, now we have this group of miners, and they are going to pull transactions from the users, right? They're going to determine the order, and they're going to create blocks, and these blocks will have an ordering of those transactions. And the blocks in proof of work, for instance, are created, voted on by mining. And that means, you know, running a bunch of hash functions or burning a bunch of energy in the process. And so that's kind of our votes on what the main chain is. So these, you know, once again, they'll pull transactions and then they'll vote on the ordering. These miners will vote on the ordering. And so they do this again and again, and they, you know, build up a chain of transactions. And so now if the users want to see, okay, which transaction came first, they can look at that chain and they can see, oh, okay, so the white hamster got the money first, and then the brown did, and then the white gerbil later on. So that seems great. But now there's this concept of forking. So if miners do not necessarily agree on the transaction history ordering, they can build up a fork, what is called a fork. And which do we choose? So this brings in kind of the fork choice rule. And the fork choice rule based normally says, okay, we choose the longest chain. And so because of, you know, maybe network latency or maybe even malicious activity, this fork continues to grow and the miners continue to disagree on what the main chain, you know, what the main history is. And so this fork eventually grows larger than the previous one. And so which do we choose? Well, now we actually have to choose this new fork. And so what does that mean? That means that these two transactions from before are now not going to be included. And instead, we're going to choose these transactions where the, you know, the brown sends to the gold instead of the, you know, red sending to the white. Now, that's called a reorg. And reorgs are not too fun because, well, this group of, you know, users doesn't want to see their transactions, no longer be a part of history. They don't want that kind of risk. And so, thankfully, with a, you know, honest majority assumption, these reorgs are not very frequent. In they're generally we find that these chains, they build up a single longest chain, and that history doesn't change very much. And the better your consensus protocol, normally the better, you know, the fewer reorgs you'll get. However, there is sometimes an issue, and this is the 51% attack problem. And so essentially, a bad cat can spend a bunch of money, let's say $500,000, to essentially recruit a bunch of, you know, evil miners to pollute the mining set and make it so that the honest majority is no longer a majority, and now we have like these dishonest miners that want to reorg the chain. And so that gets rid of our not too many reorgs property, which we really like and is really the whole point of having miners in the first place. They're deciding on transaction ordering. And so what we really want to do is we want to make it so that this cost of $500,000 is, you know, $500 million, as high as possible, so that these attacks are not actually even feasible. And so how can we do that? Well, we can try using Plasma. So what we'll learn during this consensus protocol section of the course is we'll learn, you know, about consensus protocols, and this includes proof of work, proof of authority, proof of stake, honesty assumptions, the bribing attacker model, and fault attribution, griefing analysis, and even more synchrony assumptions. So this is what we'll do when we turn PayPal into something like Bitcoin or Ethereum. So now we'll take it a step further and add to the security of the chain by using Plasma. So we'll go from PayPal to Bitcoin, then Bitcoin to Plasma. And so what Plasma allows us to do is commit to ordering on the root chain and provide dispute resolution on a secure root chain. So let's see what that really means. So on the left, we have our secure root chain, and on the right, we have our less secure PayPal chain. And the 51% attack cost is $500 million here and $500,000 here. And so we clearly want 51% attacks or these reorgs to be extremely costly, more on the order of $500 million than $500,000, for instance. And so to do that, we'll use this chain as our root security chain. So let's see how that works. So tokens are going to be transacted on the PayPal chain, and that gives us the high transaction throughput of our custom chain and custom chain logic if we want to implement it. But at the same time, token balances are going to be ultimately decided on the root chain. So that means that and disputes will be mediated on the root chain. So the way that this works is we'll create a block, and that block will contain a bunch of transactions, you know, transaction ordering. And then that block will be submitted as a transaction to this secure root chain. And that means that it will get confirmed. And so we'll create another block, submit a transaction to the root chain, that block will be confirmed. And so now the users, if instead of looking at this kind of less secure PayPal chain for their, you know, view on what the real history is, they'll look instead to the view of this secure root chain, and they'll say, okay, my coins are safe because the coins are all in the root chain and the ordering of those coins are also in the root chain. So what does this actually mean? Well, that means that if a bad cat attacker wants to 51% attack our PayPal chain, they can do it. They spend $500,000 and they create an invalid block. However, it's no problem, because now our gerbils can say, okay, well, you can do that, but we can provide evidence to the root chain that you just misbehaved, and the root chain will act as a mediator and submit all of those coins and send them back to the gerbils who really own them. So even if you do a 51% attack of our maybe less secure chain, the coins are still safe because of the root chain. And so it, you know, disables that attacker, and the attack failed, and we get something that looks closer to $500 million of security than this $500,000. So go Plasma. Awesome. So what we'll learn while we implement this during the course is we'll learn about layer two scaling, like state channels and Plasma. And we'll also learn about accumulators and Merkle trees, RSA accumulators, and fault proofs and block withholding and even more cryptography and a few more cryptoeconomic mechanisms. So we'll have a lot of fun, you know, messing with our protocol here, adding to it and you know. It'll be a lot of fun. So PayPal will have gone throughout the course, will have gone from a centralized service to a decentralized payment processor, and then all the way to a really secure decentralized payment processor. And we'll learn a lot in between. A lot of these design principles that are used to build Ethereum and build, you know, all of these protocols will be included. And not only that, a full coding project, if you would like, you know, you'll be able to code all these things up and have a probably very sophisticated, relatively speaking, chain just by going through this course. So what, in the very end, we'll kind of wrap up with a little like future of blockchain stuff with prediction markets, DAOs, token models, and, you know, a bunch of other things, including artificial intelligence, my favorite topic. But yeah, so that'll be about that. So let's learn cryptoeconomics, right? Where to go next? So this course is coming soon. It's not yet finished. It's in the process, and we're working very hard. And, you know, of course, you can find the lectures that we've got on cryptoeconomics.study and the book and the form. So awesome. And this is thanks to, you know, Aparna, Jing, myself, and Blockchain Education Network, and many other community members like, you know, Vitalik, Vlad, and, you know, Joseph, and Dan Robinson, and, you know, a million other people that I you know, wish I could name. Phil Dine, everyone. I just love it. Oh, such a huge community and lovely people, and one of those people is you. So this is really important. I really hope that, you know, we can learn all about cryptoeconomics and kind of make the world a better place, because it really, we have the opportunity, we have the tools, we have the design patterns, we can make the world a more balanced, fair, power distributed, like positive place, which, you know, I don't know, that's why I get up in the morning. So let's do it. So go to cryptoeconomics.study, enjoy the cuteness of this puppy, and let's learn.